Hi, welcome to our Regeneration Noon Connection on this Tuesday, June 2nd, 2020. I just started the video and look what they brought me, these birthday candles and this cake. Today happens to be my birthday, but I just wanted to blow these out. Do you remember when we used to blow out candles at birthday cakes and that was kind of a normal thing? But now it's not normal under these circumstances, so I'm just gonna blow these out here. But today I wanted to talk to you, share some things with you that if you have been scrolling through social media, whether it would be Instagram or Facebook, maybe you saw there were a lot of people just putting a wall just of black, and it was kind of Blackout Tuesday, and the whole thing is about racism. The whole thing is a desire to show people that, you know, this is an important thing. I thought about this on Facebook Live. You know, there's a whole movement right now of people that are saying, hey, let's not post anything, let's, you know, leave it blank. But I wanted to share some things with you that I think don't really contradict, but are enhancements of understanding where we're at today, and not just as a nation, but the human race, where we are as human beings. Going all the way back, and I'm not gonna go deep theological dive today, too far back, but when you consider God created us in his image, it says in the book of Genesis that when God created them, he created them male and female in his image, he created them. So why did God create us? He created us to be image bearers of God, to be fruitful and to multiply. That means that God had desired for human beings to live in such a way that people would know that culture would multiply, that cities would multiply, that values would multiply, that there would be fruit, that things would grow, that there would be something that is going forward that really reflects back on the image of God. And all of us are created in the image of God to bear his characteristics. Now, when it comes to being an image bearer of God, there are so many times when we think of image as outwardly. We look at just the outward person, the way a person looks, the way a person dresses, the way a person's ethnicity or even nationality. But even though God created us with diversity, with a different look, a different background, a different ethnicity, we're all to be image bearers of God. So therefore, when God speaks of his people, speaks to his people, I'm going to read this to you. When it comes to what God requires of us, he makes it very simple. In fact, we go from, you look at 10 commandments, you know, in the book of Exodus, or, you know, when you go into the law of Moses. And then later on, that became 613 commandments as people tried to obey God and to follow what God would have them do. But then Micah, let me read this to you in Micah, as Micah the prophet simplifies this. It says, he has told you, O man, O human, what is good. So God is going to tell us what is good. What does the Lord require of you? And listen to this. It says, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. Now, I want to start with just the first part of that. God has shown us to do justice. One of the themes in the gospel, when you read the gospels, is the justice of the oppressed, the justice of whether it would be a widow or an orphan or a foreigner in a land, that there was this sense of God wanted to make sure that we took care of others as human beings. Here's the problem when it comes to justice. I want justice and you do as well. And I'm not, if you know me and if you've listened to me in the past, and you can go all the way back to high school for me. This is not a theme like all of a sudden this is happening and now I'm going to start talking about justice or racism. No, this is what I was brought up with. This was my heart since I could remember, of realizing that in those differences, God wanted us to appreciate one another and never degrade another human being because of their gender or because of their race, because those are sacred things that God has created us with. So coming back to do justice, if we take God out of the equation, let's take justice and say, okay, I'm gonna take God out of the equation, but I still believe in justice. Well, what's your standard? What's the standard of justice without God? Because the standard of justice without God becomes this: I am the sole judge of what is just. And when that happens, might becomes right. So if I have enough power and strength, you rip me off. You hurt me. You degraded me because of my race. You degraded me because of my ethnicity. You degraded me because of some other thing. And now justice must be served. And I'm the one who judges whether or not something is just. And it's going to be until you pay back what I say you should owe me. And it doesn't have to just be financial. It could be until you pay homage to me, until you look at the law of God in the Old Testament and it's an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But God gave that to limit people. Because without that limit, what are we doing? We're going to go full force. And man, you took one of my teeth, I'm going to take all of your teeth. You took one eye, I'm going to take both of your eyes and your family. And that's the way that justice without God becomes personal vengeance. So yes, I am saying that when it comes to justice, it is important that there's restitution, that people that do things that harm others should be accountable for that. So that's the first part of what Micah is saying, to do justice. But then the second thing it says, and to love kindness. Justice and kindness, do they actually go together? And God says, yes, do justice, love kindness. Without kindness, justice in my own personal, if I'm the sole one that makes the decision of what justice is, it's going to be different than your view, and it's going to be different than someone else's view. But God's justice is to do justice and to love kindness. And then listen to this last part of it. It says, and to walk humbly with your God. One of the greatest ways to get rid of racism, it has to be inward. It has to be in the heart. If laws are given, even if this situation where there are riots and people are angry and they're frustrated, and I get it. Again, if you watch this last Friday's Facebook Live, I get it. I hear you. I understand. I wept on the phone with a friend of mine yesterday, a black friend who's raised with a black mom and a white stepfather, and he was a police officer. And we talked about these things. And it's hard, but understand this. God desires for us as human beings not only to do justice and to love kindness, but then it says, and to walk humbly with your God. When I begin to walk humbly with God, I see people as human beings who are created in the image of God. And therefore, every person is an image bearer of God, whether they realize it or not. Now, when we think about this, I want to read this one more scripture to you. This is from the Sermon on the Mount. And when it comes to how God says that we should treat one another, listen to what Jesus says. And I just want you to hear his words, because there are politicians, and there are leaders, and there are media personalities right now. There are singers, there's actors, their voices are being magnified and everyone is sharing. But I want you to listen to the words of Jesus. And it convicts me, because this is what he says. He brought the people, his disciples, up onto a mountain, and he said this: "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." We need to be able to comfort people that are mourning with the comfort that God gives. God can bring comfort. And that comfort is not just a hope so blind comfort that says, oh, let's just act like nothing is wrong or it's going to go away. No, we should speak, we should act, we should do things about it. But listen to this. He goes on to say, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. I think in our world today, people think of meekness as weakness. That's absolutely not. Meekness is the same word that is used for a horse that is rideable. It's power that is under control. And we look at that meekness that Jesus had, and he goes on to say this, and I'm not going to go through the whole Sermon on the Mount, but blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall become sons of God, sons and daughters of the King. We reflect his image when we become peacemakers. And then he says, blessed are you when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake. So to make a stand for what's right, you will have people come against you. And when it comes to making a stand for what's right, sometimes when we break with tribalism, when we break with a political party, when we break with our family or a race, when we see something that is wrong, I'm a pastor. So if I see something wrong that another pastor is teaching, I can't say, well, you know, cover that up because he's a pastor also. Well, the same thing is true when it's someone of my race and it's someone of my occupation, when it's a police officer. And here's the thing. Jesus goes on to say this. He says, and here is such a key thing, that we are to love our enemies. Love our enemies. If we are going to make a change in this world, it has to be through love. Now I understand that laws and enforcement, and there has to be reasoning, and racism has to be rooted out. And I get that, but unless we change the heart, unless the heart is changed, and we can't change the heart, only God can do that, then we're going to be in the same place of debates and arguments and in these riots. I understand the frustration, the tension, the fear, the hurt, but we're not to act on our enemies the way that they would act on us. Because the best way to defeat an enemy is to make that enemy a friend. And if that person won't listen, then you know what my role is as a follower of Christ? My role is to love them because God loved me. See, here's a picture that I want to share. And it's a picture that I'll close with that reminds me of why should we love our enemies? Why should we act differently than they are acting towards us? And it all comes down to this. Because when Jesus died for us, the Bible says that while we were enemies, while we were at enmity with God, Christ died for us. He's the one that gives us the example. So follow Christ and follow that example. And yes, speak the truth, but speak the truth in love. Love you guys. God bless you guys. Let's pray for our nation. Let's be those people that are the image bearers of God, that really show people a different way. It's like what Miles McPherson, the pastor at San Diego, the Rock Church, said, there's a third option. It's not black versus white. It's not police versus Black Lives Matter. It's not me versus you, Democrat versus Republican. No, there's a third option. That third option is to love one another. And yes, speak the truth. And yeah, laws need to change and things need to happen in order for us to see that there is discrimination, there's racism. But the way to do it is not to become enemies. So I'm just going to pray for you guys today. Just pray for a blessing on you that are watching. Thank you for tuning in. If you could like this and share it, man, we need this message of the good news to go out. So Father, I just want to pray for my friends, my family. We thank you for your goodness to us. And we pray that we would be people that reflect that as image bearers of God. And we thank you, Lord. So protect us. God, help us to walk in truth and walk in love. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys. Love you. And Lord willing, I will see you next time.